Hatsuki, Kang Sha, a Guyon Yatu, he blight chung call, Ganingo e hung, Ganingo all. Pemo itu, top of Tarlu, Kushai van Chu Chetone. Yalenda, Petale, Mont Blanc Shat, Lau Pau, Lutio van Chu, Hatia Shan Jong Junu. To Hoppe Pau had a Yisu Jan Chang, Dunzo Pelusha, Hatle Dunzo Pelu Jehu, Toshila. And since we have a great high priest who rules over God's house, let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting him, for our guilty conscience has been sprinkled with Christ's blood to make us clean, and our body has been washed with pure water. Lutotsu pe, dunzo pe, take it, zoke it, zoo. A petalizang luge, go. Nuno petzau sha, tapelunin susha, petinetza, nunyanda colosundla, a lukoka, halutanga go. Yapeling to mokin your shan supplo, lushachi gang chita chitu, tavanchu colo gang to the lusha, a got chuche, take it, zoke inchai, take you your zing pelusundla. ก็เตนเดอตานเดเปลุชาลุนจุมอก็จอกเปจังลุเจก็นูนอยก็ชิเปลุขันยอลุโคก็ก็เคเปลุชาลุนจุก็ซุลุฟงก็มองก็ซอยังเปโอนูนอยก็เปโคตอกก็ยะเปตุวังจุฮามอนุงไงจุเปลุเนกเปฮก็เปซาละไตกงทมงดจิเยซูนเป
Good morning. It's good to see you guys. It's been a while since I've been up here to lead worship, so it's good to see all of you guys. Let's sing our songs to praise our Lord and our Savior this morning together.
Thank you.
Done for me.
1 John 3, verse 10. By this, the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. Anyone who does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor the one who does not love his brother. Lord, help us today. Open up our spirit to receive your word. Show us where we are weak. Show us where we are broken, so that we may put you, we may make you Lord of these things. Lord, we thank you for giving us life today, the things that we do to earn our daily bread. Lord, today we bring a portion of that to offer up to you. Help us, Lord, to offer it freely, willingly, happily, without any anxiety. Help us to put our faith and trust in you and not of these things in this world. And Lord, we pray that all that we do today will be to honor and glorify you and only you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Emmanuel, Lafayne, Ha, Changfu. Do we miss anybody? I think we're missing one. Pejon Shack, you want to from Komojo, Putra, Pepper and Jane, more Tumoki, Pete, Tuteki, Ha, more Saint Lucentu, and now you're to come out of the old one to Chow, no, no, Poco. Sau xa thì bố thì mình nhớ và vẫn chú bố và bố giờ đang ăn cho nó phi đồ chú giờ lên đây cú giờ mốt bố giờ mình nhớ phi đồ vẫn chú cú giờ nhảy y ngài vẫn được cú ha cho lên đây cho xí hết cho bố giờ nãy chỉ lên hà ở bên lù ha cú mà lên mốt bố giờ mình nhớ phi đồ vẫn chú bằng cái chuyện bố bé tao hạ tay giờ cho nãy cho chỉ phụ vẫn chú ha bố nông vẫn chú lù để vẫn chú chú có mong yon lên được bố mong cho bố giờ mình nhớ đau tạ But the love of the Lord remains forever with those who fear him. His salvation extended to the children's children of those who are faithful to his covenant and of those who obey his commandments. Can you have a mic? So,
hi everyone. I think Esther and I, we are just extremely grateful and thankful this year. God has blessed us with baby Eli. He is now 6 months now, going on 7 months, and it's just been an amazing journey. Your life is forever changed, but he's just been an amazing blessing, and we just wanted to come up here, give him up to God, and hope that God uses both Esther and I to help cultivate a good lifestyle to help point Eli to him every single moment of his life. So, we're just extremely grateful and thankful to have baby Eli with us.
The wife can say too if you want.
Good morning, church. If you guys don't know me, I'm Gabriel, and my wife, Savannah. We just had Zephaniah Vang. His Hmong name is Tengang Toju. So, and we've been blessed with him in October 4th. He's 2 months. And he's been a great blessing for Savannah and I. Definitely life-changing, but definitely a blessing. And we've been learning how to just be parents and just to remember that you know, we have to trust in God through all of phases of his life, just because he's so small and we're so worried all the time. But yeah, always got to trust in God. And yeah, we just want to come up here to have you guys as witnesses to come and just help us to take care of him and to teach him as well. To be a man of God, so we are excited to just have you guys help us with that, and just continue to pray for us too as we continue to just be parents, and just allow us to just help us to help him to grow in Christ as well, and help us to teach him correctly as well. So yeah, thank you.
Good morning, everyone. We just, you know, are so happy that we have baby Hazel here. Truly a blessing from the Lord. We just really want to dedicate her and her life to the Lord, and you know, whatever he sees fit to have her be and have her do as she grows up. You know, may his will be done through her. We just, you know, want to do our best as parents to guide her to learn about God and to love God. And so we ask that you be praying for us whenever you remember us, and be praying for her as well. And we know whenever we come to church or we see each other, feel free to help us raise her as well. So she's having a good time, you know, play with her. If she's being bad, you know, say a couple words to her. Regardless, you know, we just want her to love God and love the Lord.
Morning, everybody. Yeah, Catherine and I didn't think we'd be up here so soon again. After Phoenix, we're just so blessed to have Psalm in our lives. He's been such a blessing to us. He's always so happy, and yeah, nilumbe mong ya lo, and yeah, nilonzi si. We're extremely blessed to be a part of this church where he's loved and can be raised in the Lord's name. And we just pray that he grows up to be a godly man and will one day be able to become a leader and lead others as well.
All right, similar to Chris, we didn't expect to be standing up here for the fourth time, but this is our baby son, our fourth son, Azariah here. We haven't come up with a Hmong name yet, so hopefully before his first birthday, we will come up with one. But it's been a true blessing. It's been a different experience every time with each child. And as many of you know, it takes a village to raise children. And so I'm starting my own little village. Now I have four. But we will rely heavily on the church and, you know, all the teachers here and, to help us, you know, raise our child. And, you know, we totally understand that it's going to be mainly our responsibility to raise them up in the ways of the Lord, but we will also rely on everybody here.
So before I dedicate your child to the Lord, I would like to ask all of you this question, and I would like to get some response. Will you pray for him and for her and with him and with her? Will you instruct him and her faithfully in the doctrines of the Christian faith? Teach him or her to read the Word of God, to pray, and to live a holy life. Take him and her faithfully to the house of the Lord on Sunday. Do all that is in your power to bring him or her to the knowledge of Jesus Christ as a Savior and Lord. Will you do that? Okay. So because of your promise before God and his people, I will pray for your child. Okay, so let me start from here over there. Make sure that I know all the name. All right. So make on shadow kui a be thawan chu to. Azariah kumoka feature on the vanchu valing si vanchu valing to ha vanchu vanchu pli ta vanchu fo ko mo jong pu tro ka chen ga la ta ko ka lu tu ta lao ta che ta na ta si ta vanchu tun ru pli o tlen ro to ka lu neng ha hu ka lu to vanchu lu te cha ko ta ka lu lu ka pao zai nu o ka tu chu tu cha shen ha shi ka o ni te tlen no mo su no ke ni lu to lu la te no Sam ko moka fi chon da wan chu waling zi wan chu waling to ha wan chu wan chu pli ha wan chu fong ko mong pu tro ka lu che ko ka lu lu ta lao ta che ta na ta zi ha wan chu tun chu pli ot len lu tro ka lu nei ha hu ka lu ko tho ka lu lu le ka pao lu zai yu chi yesu ka tu chu tu che shen ha wan chu shi ka o ne te len no mong su no ko ne lu tro lu bla te no Hazel ko moka fi chon da wan chu waling zi wan chu waling to ha wan chu wan ru pli ta wan chu fong ko mo jong pu to ko ka lu lu ta lao ta che ta na ta zi ta wan chu tun ru pli o tlin no to ka lu nei ha hu ko lu zai yo ji ye so ne tu chu o ka tu chu tu cha shen ta wan chu shi ka o ne te tle ten no mo zo no ke ne lu to lom la te Zephaniah ko moka fi chon da wan chu wan ling zi, wan chu wan ling tu, ha wan chu wan ru pli. Ta wan chu fong ko mo zhong pu tro ka tiang ga tla ta ko ka lu lu ta lao ta che ta na ta zi. Ta wan chu pli o tien nu tro ka lu neng ha hu ka lu, ko ka pao lu zai yu chu yi su ka tu chu tu cha shing. E wan chu shi ka o ne te tle te nu mo tsu nu ke ne to kan lu, to lu mla te nu. Eli ko moka fi chon da wan chu wan ling zi, wan chu wan ling tu, ha wan chu wan ru pli. Ta wan chu fong ko mo jong pu tro ka tiang ga tle ta ko ka lu lu ta lao ta che ta na ta zi ta wan chu tun ju pli o tle no tro ka lu nei ha hu ka lu ko ka pa lu zai yu ji yesu ka tu chu tu cha shi ta wan chu shi ka o ni te tle te no mo zo no ko ni ta kan lu tu lu la te no e tai tho cho ya no da ji yesu lu de a thank you everybody you may have go seat Mekong Shandu ko pe thawang chu to ja family na ya. Wan chu pe lu o ka chau to ka chu kom mong to pe pan jing. E ka pu to pe mo na mo chi pe jan na ja chi ha mo tu mo ki pe te tu te ki ha mo sing lo sing zu. E pe shuo da te no po leng ya kom mong da ka. Nu no ja ku ya na ya chi po ta lu shau ti no ha lu mo po ja mi nyo fi to ka. Po cho lua ta van chu po yo kha tu mi nyo po yo cho tu mi nyo po yo nyi ka chu lu tu tu mi nyo ha po yo cho tu mi nyo to church e ko thau lu 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 je pau ka ha yo lu zai yo ka ha yo van chu ka te 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 mo e tha ka phong ko mong jong pu tro po te lu cho che ko cha sha to po lu nei ha pang to po tu mi nyo e po yo na yo jin de shang jian ga lai ta te tha ka pang ko po mo tlang mo ju mo khu ko mo nya mo za lu pu to te minyo ko mo na mo hao ha lu lu da shang jian ga le ta je po yan na ye zi lu sha lu ju te ka ye wang chu e ta ka hu ta ka pang ka wo le no to je minyo lu nei ko ta po lu lu le po pao ka po zhe le zai yo ka po tu chu tu je sheng ha lu wang chu ka lu lu le te no mo zu no ke tang po zu sha hu lu ba te no te mo po je to nei yao ku ta shao tian no je minyo mo fi to ka Cause I let that go to among the Jesus one day. Ah.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
What a beautiful Sunday morning, and always grateful, always blessed to be with all of you during this time, and especially for me to share the Word of God, to encourage you, to challenge you, and to help you to grow in your faith. Trust that you're all doing well and that you will enjoy this time as well. Before we start the day, before we jump into God's Word, let us start off with prayer. God, your wonderful, loving, and merciful grace allows us to gather on this beautiful Sunday morning. And so we thank you that we have this opportunity by the blood of Jesus Christ to be your people, to be your church, and to hear the preaching of your word. May you grant us strength and understanding. May you lead us through your Spirit. May your Spirit open our eyes and give us clarity to hear the goodness of 1 John chapter 3. And so may you bless us during this time. And may you be glorified as well. We pray all this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. How can we tell that someone is a Christian, is a believer? Because over the centuries, people have used different symbols, pictures, images, to identify, to reveal to the world that they are a believer. And I trust that as you go into the world, as you live in the world, that you would understand and know these things as well. People, they wear necklaces with a symbol of a cross. Some have tattoos of a cross, maybe even a Bible passage on their body. Drive around enough and you will see the fish emblem, or maybe the not of this world bumper sticker on their car. There's nothing wrong about these things. It's a cool way to express yourself as a Christian, as a believer. And I trust that some of us, we might even have these things on us, tattooed on us, might be wearing a necklace with a cross, might have these cool stickers on our car. There's nothing wrong about these symbols, but there's a greater symbol. There's something even better about the Christian. It's not these emblems or these handmade things or things that were thought of by the human mind. Because what I'm talking about, it's more than just a symbol. It's something about who we are as a believer. Towards the conclusion of Jesus' earthly ministry, he gives the disciples a command. And he calls it a new command. A command that is supposed to mark all faithful Christians throughout the centuries. And so in John chapter 13, verse 34 to 35, Jesus says, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." Love. Love is to be the mark of the Christian. It's more than a symbol, more than a sticker that you slap onto the back of your car. Love is the mark of the believer. This is who the Christian is, according to Jesus. Now, Jesus, he is love. He taught on love fervently. But who is there also more qualified to talk about love than the disciple or the apostle John himself? John, he was a follower of Jesus Christ, having walked, lived, and done ministry with Jesus. So he learned firsthand, and he experienced love through the life of Jesus Christ. And not only that, but John was also the disciple that was loved dearly by Jesus. And many people refer to John as the apostle of love, because throughout his writings in the Bible, the love or the theme of love is a reoccurring thing. If John was to have a major in life, it would be love. It would be love. He was touched by love. He was changed by love. And now he encourages the church, the believers here in his first epistle, to love one another. If you have your Bibles, please turn to 1 John chapter 3, verse 11 to 18. 1 John chapter 3, verse 11 to 18. The book of 1 John was an important epistle, especially during this time as many false teachers had risen up in the church, was causing the believers, the early church, to doubt their faith, to turn away from the church, to hate one another. These Gnostics, they had entered the church and said that you are unable to know God. You're just this little person. You're this sinful person in this physical life. Jesus, he couldn't have come down to this world, because if he did, he was a sinful person. And so to combat these false teachers and to give assurance to the believers, John promotes love and to love one another. And so, follow with me. 1 John chapter 3, verse 11 to 18. It says this: "For this is the message that you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. We should not be like Cain, who was of the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own deeds were evil and his brother's righteous. Do not be surprised, brothers, that the world hates you. We know that we have passed out of death into life because we love the brothers. Whoever does not love abides in death. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has no eternal life abiding in him. By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. But if anyone has the world's goods and see his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth." So again, I ask you, church, what is the mark? What is the proof that a person has genuine faith? Is a believer? And let me put it another way. How do we test ourselves that we have this faith in our lives? That we are reborn? That we are different from other people in this world? To John, it is love. And to have love for one another. Have love and to love one another. Because love, it is the greatest confirmation to you and I, to people who look at us, that we are his children. This is how people will know and understand that we are Christians in the first place as well. And so, based on this rationale, there are three questions that we must ask ourselves, that we must ask each other. The first question is, why is this love important. Why is this kind of love important? It is important because it is the heart of the gospel. It is the heart of the gospel. John says in verse 11, "This is the message that you have heard from the beginning." It's always been this message. It's always been what Jesus taught the disciples when he started his ministry. Love has always been the teaching of the apostles as well. It's always been a part of who they are, what they taught, and what they challenged the church to be. And it is why John essentially says a chapter earlier, "I have nothing new that I am teaching you. I have this old commandment that is a new commandment from Jesus. There's nothing new, nothing different that I am teaching you." Our methods will always change from person to person, culture to culture, from time to time. But the message will always remain consistent. It will always be the same message. Love. And to love one another. Thus, if you and I say that we are followers of Jesus, then there must be this continual love in our life and in our church as well. It must be consistent to what the apostles taught and what they heard from Jesus Christ himself. And this command, it's always in a present tense. It must be happening now, in our lives now, in the church now. It must be taking place currently in this time and age. It is also important because it reveals to you and I if we belong to God or if we belong to the evil one. This love is important because it reveals who we are. Are we God's people or are we Satan's people? And so John, he uses the story of Cain and Abel in Genesis chapter 4 as a case study. And we should know well the story of Cain and Abel, the two first brothers in human history that ended in sadness and tragedy. Cain was a farmer. Abel, his brother, was a shepherd. And when the time came to offer a sacrifice to the Lord, Abel brought the best. He brought the firstborn of the animals and the fat portions. But Cain, he brought something from the ground. He brought fruits. And so God chose Abel's offering because it was righteous, because it was good over Cain's fruit offering. And Cain, in his jealousy and his hatred, murdered his brother in cold blood. Sadness and tragedy. In verse 12, John says, "We should not be like Cain, who was of the evil one and murdered his brother." And why did he murder him? Because his own deeds were evil and his brother's righteous. From Cain, avoid jealousy. Avoid jealousy. Abel, he presented a good and righteous offering to the Lord, and it was accepted. Cain was so jealous to the point where he was so mad, to the point where he had to kill his brother. This downward spiral in life. Thus, why John says that Cain was of the evil one. He belonged to Satan. Because Satan, only Satan bears such evil, wicked acts in life. From Abel, what must we expect? If you are a person of righteousness, a person of love, expect to be hated. Expect to be hated by the people in this world because of your godly lifestyle. If you are faithful, righteous, God-fearing, honorable, if you love God and you love others, expect to be hated. Expect hostility from the people in this world. Love and hatred, they're connected. They're always connected. And Jesus connects the two as well. In his gospel, chapter 15, verse 12, Jesus talks about this relationship between love and hatred. He says you are to love one another. If you love one another, you are my disciples. But then a few verses later, in verse 18, Jesus says, the world hates you. The world hates you. Know that it has hated me first, though. So love and hatred, understand that they are connected. They are related to one another. Don't be surprised, as John says here in his first epistle. Don't be surprised then. Because if you have love, don't be surprised that people are going to hate you and I, that people are going to hate the church. Don't be caught off guard. Don't be surprised at the hostility that you will face in your workplace. Don't be surprised when our kids face enemies at school because of their love for God. Do not be surprised by the world's hatred of you living out your faith. That you love God, that you love one another. In this world, we know that there are dangerous jobs. Think about the soldiers in the front line when they go into war. They are going to get shot at. They can't be surprised by it. Oh, they're shooting at us. What are we going to do? Soldiers cannot be surprised on the front line in war. Athletes, no matter how well they train their mind and their body, they cannot be surprised that if they're going to push their body to the peak level of performance, that injury, broken bones, torn ligaments is going to happen. Race car drivers, accidents are going to happen if you're driving at 200 miles per hour. We can't be surprised. If we love God, hatred is going to come at you and I. But understand though, it hated Jesus first. Jesus was hated by the people during his time. Because of his love and his sacrifice, we can be here as a church. And now we, in our love, our honor, our faith to him, we will also be hated as well. We must know why this love is important, because it is also a sign of spiritual life. It is a sign of spiritual life. When a believer loves one another, as we have been seeing here in our passage and have been learning, it proves that you and I, we really have genuine, sincere faith. But what takes place for the believer, for you and I? What happens for you and I? According to verse 14, the Christian's ability to love one another is a guarantee that you and I, one day when this world is no more, we will have eternal life. It's a sure, secure sign that God gives to you and I when we trust in him. And so when one person, as John says, when one person passes from death to life, then everything changes. Life is different. Our outlook is different. Our actions are different. Our heart and our mind is different. We have a different family all of a sudden. Everything is different for you and I. But most importantly, the biggest difference is that we have eternal life. We have eternal life. Contrary to that, a person who does not love and does not love one another does not receive spiritual life. And their condition, it remains in, it abides in death. Spiritual death. And John, he's very black and white about this. There's no gray area. No murderer has eternal life, he says. Sit on that for a little bit. No murderer has eternal life. Might be thinking, I didn't kill like Cain killed. I didn't kill my brother. You don't even have to actually commit murder. If you have jealousy, if you have hatred, you kill your brother in your mind and in your heart. You don't have to commit the act of killing. All you have to do is just think it. And you are a murderer. Jesus, he emphasizes this in Matthew chapter 5, 22 as well. Nothing new. Nothing new. Such people like this, the murderer, will not have eternal life. Question number two. What is the nature of this love? So we're going from why it's important to what is the nature of this love? We know what love looks like because Christ, he has shown it to us. We see it here in verse 16 at the beginning. While Cain's jealousy led to hatred, which led to murder. Jesus' love, it leads to self-sacrifice. It is a sacrificial nature. And so Jesus, he declares in John 15, 13, greater love has no one than this, that someone would lay down his life for his friends. And consider the fact that in 1 John chapter 4, 10, God, he loved us and he sent his son Jesus to be the propitiation for our sins. Have you ever heard of the word propitiation? This cool theological word. It's a word that we all should know and understand. Propitiation. It's a word that is used to describe the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, and especially what Jesus' sacrifice does for you and I. Propitiation. There's two things that's involved in this. The act of appeasing, or if you want to say, pleasing God's wrath. Something had to appease God's wrath, his righteous anger and judgment on humanity for their sins. What can satisfy God's wrath? And what can reconcile, bring us back to this level standing with God? The sacrifice of Jesus Christ. That's what propitiation is and what it means and what it looks like. It's about pleasing the wrath of God. And it's about reconciling us, bringing us back to this rightful relationship with God the Father. Propitiation was so important because the priests, guess how many times they would have to make offerings to God to appease for the sins of mankind and to even appease for the sins of the priest himself. Daily, weekly, monthly, annually, priests would have to sacrifice over and over and over and over again. But none of those things could satisfy the wrath of God until the ultimate and the final sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Hebrews chapter 7 talks about the final sacrifice, the sacrifice once for all, the greatest, the bestest sacrifice of all time for all people. A sacrifice that would ultimately satisfy God's judgment. That would actually bring us to God. This is what the sacrificial nature of love looks like. Because it literally costs a life. A perfect life in Jesus Christ that would atone for all sins in this world. It is by this, John says, that we know love. So love, it's more than just this mystical or this philosophical thinking. It's more than that. It's more than just romance, this mood that we have, this feeling for another, or sentimental words, right? Because for us as Christians, love is at the cross. At the cross where Jesus sacrificed his life for you and I. This is where we go to see love displayed. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still weak, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Christ died for us. So if we could summarize what this love is, it would be passion. It would be passion and purposeful. He suffered for you so that you and I could be his children. It is passionate and it is purposeful. First question, why is this love important? The second, what is the nature of this love? And the last question, the third question here is, how can you and I demonstrate this love for one another? How can we love one another then, according to what we have learned here? Jesus demonstrated his love for us through his sacrifice. And so, John says, we must do the same. We must lay down our life for each other as well. We must love sacrificially. And John, he gives us a very practical example here. Easy for us to do. In verse 17, he speaks about someone who has material needs, who is wealthy, who has enough, who is doing well. And a follower of Jesus who would have the ability to meet other people who don't have anything, who are in need of something. And so John, he asks this question regarding the person who has the ability to meet someone's need, but is unwilling to, but shuts off himself from the person of need. How does God's love abide in you? If you see someone who is in need and you don't give to them, how does God's love abide in you? How does it abide in you? Is there even God's love in you? Are you even regenerate? Have you been reborn? Are you a Christian? How can we claim to love God if we are unwilling to love each other? If you love God, then you must love others. Because like Christ, he had a generous life. He offered his life for you and I. So, what can we do? Be sensitive. Be attentive. If you see someone in the church who is in need, who needs hope, who needs love, who needs help, maybe even financially, or in the way of food, clothing, anything. If you see someone who is in need, don't shut off yourself from them. But open yourself, give yourself to one another. Maybe you can take them out. Account for them over dinner, over coffee. Maybe you can buy food for the family. Maybe you can even give financially to the family. You can do anything for a person in need. It's a practical example that John gives us. We are to be generous with our life. And we need to be generous to people who are in need. Don't be selfish, but be generous with your belongings, with your time, with your resources, with your family even. This is how we can love one another. Be generous. Exemplify to each other that you know God and that you love Him and that you love others as well. Show them grace. Show them mercy, kindness. Show them love, the things of our faith. Provide it to them. And at the same time, John, he encourages us. It's more than just words. We can love more than just through our words. But we need to act it out. We need to love in deed and in truth. We need to love more than just the words that we can express to one another. We need to actually live out love for one another. John, he's not going to allow you and I to just merely talk about love, because we need to act this out in our faith. Real love, it's demonstrated in actions. And so if we see a person in need, again, physically meet that person's need then. As I said, account for them. You can take them out. Go enjoy a time together. Purchase for them what they need in life. Provide for one another. It's that practical. We live in a world where talk is cheap. We can say anything, but we won't do everything. We can say anything we want, but we won't live everything. Talk is cheap. So many people can talk and talk and talk and talk, but they don't live it out. They don't express it through their lives. Talk is cheap. Because what is the difference between a believer and an unbeliever? If all we do is just talk, there's no difference. Nothing at all. So church, prove your love and action to one another. Because if we do so, then we will be different from this world. We will actually be different from unbelievers. And we can tell, we can really tell who is a Christian and who is not a Christian. If we love one another, not just through words, but through our actions, then we are marked people. We are marked people. We are His people, and not people of the world, or even Satan's people. We are children of love. In conclusion here, we have seen that the Christian is symbolized by love. They are marked by love, and love especially for one another. Here in the church, and even for unbelievers. We read this at the very beginning. In verse 10, John writes, "By this it is evident who are the children of God and who are the children of the devil. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is the one who does not love his brother. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be known or even called as the child of a devil. Who wants to be called a child of the devil? That's a sad title. That's a wicked title. I don't want to be known as the devil's son, the devil's daughter. No, who wants to be known by evil acts, wickedness, jealousy, hatred, selfishness? I don't want to be known as a child of the devil. And it's a harsh truth that John shares to all of us. And maybe we need to hear this as well. Who wants to be known as a child of the devil? Because if you and I, if we lack love, if anyone lacks love, they will lack life. All they will get is death. And that is where they will reside. That is what will be a part of their life. So let us strive to love one another, to be known as not the child of the devil, but the child of God. Strive to love and love one another and do it faithfully so that you will be marked by God as his son and as his daughter. If you ever doubt that you are a child of God, if you fall shy of loving one another, or if you don't know how to love like what the Bible says, then continue to ask yourself the three questions. Test yourself with the three questions that we looked at. Why is this love important? What is the nature of this love? And how can we demonstrate it to one another? How can we show it to one another? Ask yourself and test yourself against these three questions to see if you have genuine faith, that if you are a believer, so that you will have the mark of love and so that life will not flee from you. Church, love. Love one another. Strive to love each other. It is the greatest evidence that someone has true saving faith. So as you go out today, love one another. Let us pray. God, we are grateful again for your grace that we can gather and to hear the preaching of your word. Lord, there are many things that reveal who we are. There are many things that we can do as well. But above all, may we prove to this world, may we prove to ourselves, may we prove to you as well that it is love, that we love one another. And that is why we are children of God, not children of the devil. Give us encouragement, push us, motivate us, help us to strive to love each other, to test ourselves in this manner, to help us to see that we are actually your people. But we also thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, as well, who demonstrated the greatest act of love by giving himself, by dying on the cross for us. And it is because of that that we can be here, can be your church, and can continue to live and to breathe and to love through this legacy, through the legacy of Jesus' love. Help us to be faithful to you in this manner from centuries to century, from church to church, from believers to believers. So we thank you for your love for us as well. And as we leave, Lord, help us to love you with all our heart, our mind, our soul, our strength, and to be able to love one another as we love ourselves. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.